glad to be moderating this panel today, which is on the important topic of building the business case for HR transformation. I'm sure if HR transformation is on your mind, the first thing that comes is how do we get the sponsorship from business? How do we make business involved in the entire HR transformation so that it doesn't become only the HR or IT project? Because HR transformation is one project that impacts each and every employee of your organization. So we have a very esteemed panelist today, and it would be insightful to hear from them, their experiences, their insights in the HR, in the entire HR transformation. So let me start with you, Jagan, and in your experience, what is the importance of building a business case for HR transformation, and how do we ensure that business is involved in the entire process?
Okay. It's a very big question. I'll attempt to simplify that. Yeah. Yeah. Business case is very important because it means money, time, effort, and conflicts, and so many things. From Mahindra and Mahindra, I will take you back to 2013, where we did the HR transformation. To simplify, what is the transformation? It is about we brought in the centers of excellence and business partnering, that's employee partnering and business partnering, BHR. Then we have the shared services. This is all about it. So after that journey has started, we did the lift and shift both in hiring and also the employee transaction processing, both the areas. I think we are among the first or probably the only company who did the complete lifting and shifting. So that's one point to stay on. Next is the journey has gone by, and then I have come into this role. When I looked at the shared services, how it is functioning, there were too many teething issues. Obviously, if there is one error, we extrapolate, the whole thing is actually falling through. That is something I could get to hear. And number two, there were a lot of material impacts. Say, for example, someone rolled out a wrong offer letter that meant some extra money, or it could be non-compliance that's happening. So host of other things. What it boiled down to is doing too much of man management. Why the hell you didn't comply to this process, and hence I will issue a show cause notice, what not, you can imagine. So this is exactly what was happening. Second thing is, one of the meetings we were with MD, and he said, it looks so ugly, there is something called EP, employee portal. It starts with the exit. If you want to leave the company, start with that exit, you know, that kind of an interface it had. It looked very ugly. Another time, this president of one of the sectors, that is auto sectors, he calls me to his office and says the cost is actually blowing up, and it seems shared service cost is too high. Can we actually reduce this cost? So these are the dimensions. Next is with respect to the employee. We get good impressions in some places it's not, and it's a hell lot of issue, you know. When I looked at the whole thing, systems are disjoined. For a basic thing like if you want a Form 16, for example, the shared service partner will have to depend on M&M because we didn't give access. There's too much of confidentiality. It is always overrated, you know, confidentiality. So that's exactly used to create a lot of lags, and then it used to hit the employee experience. I know many of these things are hygiene, and certain things which can impact emotions of individual can lead to whatnot, okay. So if you look at the entire spectrum, it has warmed us up into doing something different. So that's where I stepped in terms of looking at, let me try and join the processes, different systems, and then when I looked at the deeper point, the processes themselves are not actually evolved. They're still broken, they're isolated, too many controls, which comes naturally to HR folks, right? Too many controls. And hence you need so many decisions, and so there's too much of turnaround. So I embarked on the journey, something called point solutions I came out with. And when I looked at the listing of point solutions, it's about 150 in number, 150. And so I started with one point solution. That is about the compensation review module. And I don't know how many IT folks are here. We handed this to them to custom build it. Eventually what happened is it took almost 1.5 to 2 years. And we ended up having the military support, means the programmers had to come and sit in the office to run our compensation exercise. So long thing short, that didn't really take off. Then I came with a complete transformation exercise, you call it 2.0 or whatever. Point solutions is not working. Now I'll have to go into a different approach, that is in terms of bringing the configurable platforms. We had a good success of PMS using SuccessFactor, and then that really gave us a business case. Okay, it is not something meant to be done because we had a PMS which was broken, and then we implemented the SuccessFactors PMS on this platform, we could actually drop a cost of 80 lakh rupees, year on year recurring cost. Simple interventions. Just we did the validations on the system. So that gave rise to confidence, and I had to tell my boss, who became a sponsor in the process, that this means something, we can make it more and more effective, it is not just the workflows. I had put a case of even the employee experience also, process maturity to an extent of n equal to 1. Because hygiene is given, if someone is betting their transformation, etc., only for cost reduction, we are wasting our time. It's not a real ROI. So I can add more points
great.
Later.
Great, and being from SuccessFactors, we're proud to hear that, Jagan. So Adir, what is in your perspective, how did you go about with all this journey of HR transformation, and how did you build the business case? How did you get business sponsorship?
It's important to know that, first of all, as an HR function, we can't operate in an isolation. So therefore, it's important to understand what's the strategic intent of the business first. In our case, it's typically, we were known as a large lifestyle kind of a conglomerate. I represent Raymond. And we were moving from a manufacturing kind of an setup or a kind of a manufacturing focus. We moved into a lifestyle space where we mean that we will move from manufacturing to solutions to services businesses. And that means a lot of stuff that has to be done in terms of from a people standpoint as well. So typically what it means for me is that from a jacket and a suit manufacturer, we move to a full wardrobe strategy. And to understand that, we need to know how does the HR sit into the entire overall perspective. What's the value chain of the business, and therefore what as an HR, where can I bring elements which will actually help and drive the transformation. So importantly, HR transformation for us is not just understanding HR and then probably doing something, but completely closely linked to businesses, and therefore driving business elements and driving the connect with business is important for us, because at the end of the day, we are a facilitator for the entire business operations. And as Jagan was also mentioning, so we've not just started something just for the heck of it. Like, I'll give a live example. We are undergoing a massive transformation in terms of a job evaluation process. I mean, the whole purpose of evaluation has to be explained, and what's in it me for the exam, for the employees, for the business, and therefore what are the, how is it going to add value to the business overall is a key element that HR needs to answer. Any transformation of any sort which is to do with HR, unless and until you have a complete ownership by the business or the project, and it means that what's the philosophy and what's the intent that you're trying to drive through HR? And therefore, is it completely aligned and closely linked to the business drivers? And therefore, if you want to look at the success factors in terms of what will be the success of such transformation, if it's not aligned, then definitely for sure, it's not going to be 100% successful, because we cannot as HR folks drive something just for as a hobby horse that we have. So just to mention the fact that unless and until you have a complete buy-in of business and you have a complete understanding of how are we going to drive and what is it in it for the employees, for the business, no amount of transformation and technology that you brought in, bring in, is going to help you transform the HR function, so to speak.
Great. Great insights, Adhir. Over to you, Ranjan. So do you agree to this perspective, and do you want to give a different perspective to the entire subject of transformation and building?
The discussion is quite surprising to me because I'm just going to give some random thoughts, right? The first thought is, in the morning I was discussing, talking to my dad, I was telling him that if you try to think of the Indian cricket team when Sunil Gavaskar was playing, can you tell me 6-7 players, do you still remember them? He thought for a while and said no. Look, can you tell me 100 players now? He said yes. So what changed? IPL. And what is IPL? It's all about communication. That's one. Second is that when I joined TCS, the first day I saw this HR guy is using a mouse. And before that, I had never seen a mouse. And I thought these guys are working in, CAD CAM. So I asked them, is this CAD CAM? No, we are in HR. I said, my God, HR is doing something with a mouse. Looks very interesting. But the very thought of a mouse, can I tell that to my daughter who is 21 years old? She doesn't even need the mouse, meaning virtually everything is happening and they are very fast. Third is, unlike any other corporation in this room possibly, I don't know, not SAP, but others, we don't have any physical assets, right? Our assets come in every day and go out every day from our office, right? So given these factors and given that we are possibly, I don't know whether all of you are aware or not, day before we crossed the market capitalization of IBM, right? So we are possibly an Indian multinational or whatever you can talk about. And I think the success has been to, you know, when we talk about a concept called charity begins at home. So everything that we give to our customers have to be given to our employees as well, because it's all about experience. And transformation, I don't know what it truly means, but I think transformation is daily. And last but not least, you know, when we talk about processes in IT, there are two kinds of things. One is called the waterfall model, top down. The other is called the spiral model, bottom up. All this terminology sounded good till about 12 years back. A concept called RAD came. RAD was rapid application development, just like JIT has always been there, right? And RAD came, we are fine. But today we are just talking about something called agile. Agile means that you don't follow processes, you have a process, but it goes on, it can happen with several stakeholders. And the end customer is also part of your process. So I think for us, transformation is daily. So it is not a process, year-long process, shared services will happen, things like that. So that's my take on that.
Great. Thanks, Ranjan, for sharing that. Nikhil, over to you. Yeah. So I got the opportunity to work with RPG very closely, and I met people from shop floor till top floor. And it's so amazing to hear that everybody is aligned to the business strategy. So how do you, from HR, how do you ensure that, and how do you go about alignment of the business case with business strategy and HR transformation?
So I think there are two aspects to the whole story. So one is, I think we just need to kind of take a step back and really understand, you know, what does the whole digital transformation actually mean, right? So we just need to take a step back and look at these two words in isolation in the first place. So first of all, I think most of us are really automating today, right? So I think we have a paper-based process which we just put on the system as of now. Second part, which is the transformation part, you know, so I will not really say that's the digital, that's more the automation part. The transformation is really what we need to understand, right? So what are we really transforming, right? Are we really transforming the way employees are consuming HR services, right? So in my earlier company that, you know, we used to do appraisals 4 times a year. That's a big, huge overkill. Right, so now you've got a great opportunity, you know, when you're going to implement a new system, to really take stock of your existing HR processes and see what real transformation you can bring about for this. Now, what kind of best practices can you bring about in the HR practices? Do you really need employees to do appraisal 4 times a year? Or can you do it 2 times a year? Or can you do it once a year? I know now SAP is going and saying we don't need to do appraisals at all, right? So I'm saying, what kind of new radical thinking are you bringing in the HR processes? Too often what's happening is that the existing HR processes are just being put onto the new system. So now it's almost like old wine in a new bottle kind of a thing, right? So I think we really need to take a step back as HR professionals, or, you know, people who are advising HR professionals. Now, what exactly do you want to do with the HR transformation? Right? So here is a great opportunity, right? We have tools and technologies available to us, as you were saying, you know, where things can really get transformed at scale, right? You can now talk about agile development within HR, right? You now have technologies where quick, rapid deployments can be done. But I think the real challenge that I see today is HR leadership stepping up and taking the opportunity, right? I think there is a lack of leadership within HR to say that we will own the system, we will do the development, we will do the transformation, we will do the change management, we'll do the adoption. So somewhere, you know, that leadership from the HR is missing. Too often it's you know, IT who is saying that here is a system, take it and, you know, go and, you know, do whatever you want to do with it. So that's where the adoption is not coming in because of that. Right? So I think these are some of my thoughts that I've got on the topic of transformation.
Sure.
I just have one submission as well. I think far too long we have actually confused technology as transformation. And that's not the case, because if you do not actually understand what's the philosophy behind transformation, what is that we are going to do, what is the transformation service of, what is the, if at all it's an employee experience improvement, what is that it going to actually yield in the ultimate analysis? I think so we have to actually differentiate between just the technology insertion and the transformation, and what is it in service of, and what is it going to deliver to the business. And that's an important distinction that we want to drive here. The point, because I have had an experience in one of the companies where, lo and bingo, the whole thing got saying that we'll have an SAP structure, this, that, the other. But I think the underlying, the overlying structure of the processes of HR were not really changed. So what kind of transformation I should driving? Therefore, it's important for us as HR folks to understand what the entire end game of transformation is about, and what is this going to deliver in the end analysis. So do not kind of get confused on technology insertion and getting a solution or technology as transformation. That's the myth that you will actually have to burst, and at you'll actually try and see what is the end game of the business, and therefore how my HR transformation sits in the entire game plan. And again, you can't do a transformation of HR in isolation of just because a hobby was that you want to drive as an HR. You want to get some fancy analytics, etc. How is it in the end game, how is it actually helping my business leader or my executive committee that I'm sitting with to make decisions or to kind of drive things very, very differently from today that he's experiencing?
Great. So, Jagan, do you agree with that?
And yeah, absolutely, yeah. So let me, I took you up to the point of how we started onto the digital transformation, okay? Digital as an enabler, okay? Just be mindful about it. Today, HR transformation that we have done using digital as an enabler is an example that is quoted in, it's a kind of a boardroom that the other people in the value chain must actually adopt. These are the following reasons. One is, in terms of the cost, that is something people would look at. We were able to get the cost reduction of 4x of what we paid for the technology and its interventions. That is a point one. Whenever I looked at the shared services and few other parts in terms of HR transaction processing or talent acquisition, we had about X number of people. I always saw through that we don't need more than 15 to 20% of that headcount that is working on that. We have reached already to the level of 40%. Another 20% is there up for a kill in shorter time. What it meant is a lot of irritations have gone away. Just to give an example, it is not just about convincing that digital is going to change the life, but you need to actually sustain that. We have actually demonstrated the examples. When we started the implementation of the digital platform, incidentally that is success factor, we had integrated about 25 different subsystems around that, you know, into the main success factor. My boss was totally upset with me. I didn't even start the process of configuring. I said, wait. Why I did that was, first I got the processes cleaned. I got the decisions committee, which is actually the cross-functional team. We pull out each of the process, we find the meaningless and redundant steps that are there, unnecessary controls by converting that into a guideline, and many other things we did. 70% of that was actually overhauling what we have been doing. They were actually lying there for decades and the same process has been continuing. So that's the first step. So for us, the technology we have chosen also, the faster turnaround was there. The whole suite of SFA implemented it about 9 to 12 months. It took only that much time, okay? We didn't take longer. So the point that I'm stressing is, that is what Adir mentioned about, you need to first look at what will actually comprise of your experience, that's the employee experience. It's not the digital always does. Now let me flip it to the technology. Technology enabled us in a situation, we had about that typical NOCs we have, right? No objection certificates. I'm just highlighting this example. We had 450 clearing agents for anyone in the NOC process. 450. This is where we exploited the technology in terms of centralizing it and giving handle to only one person for each of the process. Today, we have only five of them, from 450 down to five. This is how we have used the technology. So that is how you need to converge both of these when you use the technology, when you actually have to clean up the process, both these things. So this is how we could sustain. Next is, constantly I throw surprises. Otherwise, people lose interest in technology. Like he was rightly pointing out, most often it is the paper that gets replicated into electronic form. And when I joined, when I came into this particular role in Mahindra, constantly the discussion across the layers is about which color, which button, right, left, down. I just was fed up with this. This is not user experience. This is a user interface. That plays a role, but that is not what is ultimate. So I had to beat it down and still it keeps coming up. Now, coming into in terms of surprises, this is a point I told MD. If we are thinking that we got our ROI, but reducing 4x of the cost, we are mistaken. This is given. So then what? So analytics, he was referring to the point, it throws beautiful reports once you have the data mined, because all the transactions are lying on your system. If you don't use that data, it's of meaningless. Then you don't get ROI. Today, I would say that we haven't got any ROI. It is just the low-hanging fruits and no-brainers we achieved. So what I'm referring to is, morning Prince was talking about, all our routine work can go away. I would go to a step ahead. Even 90% of the decisions that we take on a routine basis can be ported onto the technology. That is a proactive approach. Otherwise, we are constantly into the substream mode. It is like if you take the capability building or learning and development, your life starts with identifying the needs and it ends with delivering what are the needs. Learning delivery. That doesn't. There are so many sub-functions which are attached, associated to that. Have you created that kind of an interplay? And technology is actually a blessing for you to create that kind of an interplay. If you don't do that, you have not gotten ROI. So there are many things. I'll not go on listing that. This is how I keep people saying, keep them interested in terms of using digital as an enabler for the transformation.
Great. Thanks, Jugan, for the insight. So, Nikhil, over to you. This brings me to the next question. What are the components of a business case? You know, there are many people in the audience I know who are in the process of building a business case. Yeah.
So I think I'll give you a real-life example. So one of our group companies wanted to kind of move their systems away and kind of modernize their entire legacy framework. So we did do a complete end-to-end business case for them. So I think it kind of started off with understanding what their priorities are. Yeah. So the whole HR priorities for, you know, the next couple of years or the next 5 years kind of a time frame. We also did an extensive study of what I would call as the as-is kind of, you know, technology and the process, both frameworks. So it's essential to understand, you know, what are the challenges that the company is facing, what are the limitations with the existing technology, you know, and why are you really doing this whole, you know, exercise for. So it kind of starts with the whole as-is mapping, so to speak. Then we kind of looked at various other parameters that would get impacted once we launch the new technology, right? So it could be in terms of the hard savings itself. So you could look at the existing on-premise server setups, the AMCs that you're paying, the support staff that is being there. So that would be the hard costs kind of a thing. You would also look at, you know, what kind of post the technology, what kind of impact would, you know, the technology have in terms of, say, the attrition levels, or it could be the employee engagement levels. So you kind of do a kind of a soft kind of a thing as well. Plus, it also kind of, while the harder aspects are there, But we also looked at the softer aspects in terms of, you know, today the manager doesn't have a line of sight into, you know, what kind of skill set does the employee contain, right? So the skill sets are there, but then does the manager really have a line of sight into that? Is it kind of building transparency into the system? Is it kind of, you know, building trust into the system? So I think these are some of the whole aspects that we looked at. Plus, I think what is going to be the cost for the new system? So I think that's also an important parameter. So what is the cost that you're going to pay, whether it's the subscription cost or, you know, whether it's the maintenance cost or whatever that you're going to pay for the system? And then you do a complete kind of 5-year kind of a plan, and then, you know, you actually look at the ROI that's going to come about.
Great.
So this is a practical example that I can talk.
Yeah. Ranjit, you want to share your perspective on
sure.
that?
Sure. First is, if you're talking of a business model, the best model, I think, is Kotter's 8-step framework. For people who are doing it, it's a beautiful, easy step to follow, and it starts with need identification, because, you know, the sense of urgency is what is most important. I'll give 4 or 5 examples. You know, when we talk of technology, I think we are it's a very philosophical discussion here. A is, as HR, can we try and tell the business that I'm going to help you? I'll give you an example. Today I will bring down your wage cost to revenue cost by 1%, right? And for that, what do? You don't hire laterals. People from inside get more opportunities and things like that. You do several things, you know. That's transformation, because you're telling an outcome which the business can see. 1% wage cost to revenue cost reduction. Second example, now in the process, we all talk about what is in it for me, right? And SAP is talking about appraisals not happening. And we were thinking as well that, you know, appraisals not happening, what do we do? You know, how do I motivate a person without demotivating the person? You know, and we thought that it is a very simple process. You just create a relative dashboard. You know, for the same process, you have the same dashboard. You can't have, I am doing the same job, Nikhil is doing the same job, and Nikhil has different parameters to be measured, and I have the different parameters. So you create a dashboard, and Nikhil sees relative ranking for the same process being done all over the company. Where does he or she stand? Right? Without naming who is first, who is last, at what percentile? You know, is that transformation? Third example, you know, in TCS about 5 years back, we had, even for a taxi claim, 5 levels of approvals. We said, meaning, what is this? Why give so much of dokyalatap to employees? Dokyalatap means, you know, giving problems to our employees. So up to 5,000 rupees, it is approved just like that, with an intimation coming to the immediate supervisor. You know, because Uberamai Fidai, utmost good faith, is something that you have to believe in so that the experience of your employees are good. You know, I just thought these 3 or 4 examples might talk out, because transformation has to be daily. It cannot be a agenda for a year or 24-month agenda, you know, I will do. In this agile world, every day you have to change.
Great. So we're coming to the end of our panel. Before that, Jagan, if you want to leave the audience with one message on business case for HR transformation, what would that be?
So making business case is not all that difficult. Sustaining for you to actually carry that ahead with the credibility is what is critical, so that you can get more business cases ahead.
Great. Are there one message from your side?
I think the one message for business case is, first of all, HR needs to step back and understand what are we driving? What's the people philosophy that we're driving, first of all? And then what are we actually promising as a component of the people agenda to the business? And that, I think, is very, very key and important for us to actually enable. And at the end of the day, what are my success matrices that you're going to actually enable post this transformation, etc.? If you're talking to the C-level, I think it's important for us to understand and articulate a very clear, crisp philosophy of people agenda, and what is it going to help me through this transformation? How is it actually taking my business to the next level?
Ranjan.
I just want to tell people, don't be afraid. People make mistakes, and be bold. I mean, HR has to be bold. And, you know, half the time we are afraid what the business is going to say, think. If we think like the business and try to help solve their problems, we are in it together. It is not we versus they, right? That's the only thing I would like to tell people.
No, I think I totally agree with them. I think that's my pet peeve, that, you know, the HR really needs to step up and show leadership, and it should be really owning up the matrices, owning up the final outcomes, and showing to the you know, the business that, you know, even we can do a transformation.
Thank you. So we thank all the four panelists for your insights and perspectives on this important topic. We'll open it up for question and answers. Any Q&A, any questions from our audience for the panelists? Okay, so it seems that everybody is ready with their business case and all ready for HR transformation. Thank you so much.
Thank you.